resistance is futile.
Boldly going where no show has gone before. This is the Week in Geek with David D. Squared, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Broadcasting from the Gregory Ricks and Associates Wealth Management Studios, here's D. Squared.
Greetings, people of Earth! This is the Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I am your host, D Squared. All right, let me lay out the show for you tonight. We got two guests tonight. We'll kick it all off with my boy, Frank Schiavo of CoastCon, coming up this weekend. So in five more days, right after Mardi Gras, you can head on over to Biloxi and come hang out with the guys from The Week in Geek. Me and Scungy will be out there all weekend long. And if you want, we're going to be having a memorial for our dear friend Brian Held. I'm not mentally prepared for this, so I'm sure at some point they'll be crying, but it's okay because we have an open bar and we're going to have music and, you know, tears in our beers, whatever. I don't know what's going to happen, but I guarantee you we will at least have a good time that at some point. I don't know. I'm not ready for this thing, man. I don't even know how to explain it to you. But, you know, 2 years, here we are 2 years after Brian has passed, and we're finally now, because of COVID, getting around to actually doing something with everybody. So I'm cautiously optimistic and looking forward to that, but it's an open bar, so, you know, come drown your sorrows. All right, so that'll be Frank Schiavo talking about the guests and all the great things going on at CoastCon March 4th, 5th, and 6th over there in Biloxi at the Gulf Coast Coliseum. Now, also, tonight we have Harvard professor, astrophysicist, leader of the Galileo Project, New York Times bestselling author. He's got a new book out now called EXTRATERRESTRIAL, The First Sign of Intelligent Life Beyond Earth. So the Oumuamua Observatory saw something extraterrestrial that came through or extrastellar. I don't know. It's some Star Trek word. But it wasn't from our solar system, and it came through, and it made a weird sort of maneuver. So they're thinking that maybe it's aliens. Look, I'm down with that. But you know, like, look, we know what NASA's been up to. So you know, like, we're just getting to Mars. I don't know what these other, you know, intelligent races are doing, if they even exist. I don't know. Fermi Paradox, just brain hurt. Dave, brain hurt. So we'll talk to Dr. Avi Loeb, Harvard professor and astrophysicist, about his new book. So all that being said, let's get into this. And now your top nerd news stories from around the world, brought to you by the Viridian Tea Company. Find them on Etsy. And now your top nerd news stories. All right, so topping us off in our top nerd news, we've got some TV news. We're going to talk about some important things. I felt like I went on a really weird, bad road just now, so I want to get back in a good mood. Stranger Things 4, Volume 1 is coming out May 27th. Volume 1 of Stranger Things 4, we're finally getting it. They're breaking it into two parts, so you don't have to binge the entire thing like most people are want to do these days. So they have 8 episodes coming out May 27th. Then July 1st, Volume 2 will drop. I don't believe it's because they're not done. It's simply they're trying to save marriages and lives and sleep schedules and sanity, perhaps. I don't know. But it's coming back, and I've actually had to go back and start rewatching season 3 just to kind of refresh my brain about all the things that are going on, because it's just like, you know, it's been so long. We're at 2 years now since we've heard anything from Stranger Things. So now the wait is almost over. May 27th, we'll get Volume 1 of Stranger Things. Now, Also, in the news, we have The Batman coming out this Thursday, if you've got your tickets, or technically Friday. So the new Batman with Robert Pattinson and I forgot the dude who's playing the Penguin. I don't know what to think about this movie, but, you know, look, it's getting rave reviews because it has opened, the box office has opened internationally. The UK audiences are really enjoying it, so ideally we'll enjoy it. I don't know. My 15-year-old is stoked out of his mind. You know, he's got money of his own now, and he bought his tickets like 3 weeks ago when they first dropped. So he's going out there Thursday to see the movie. So I guess I'll pick his brain and see if it's worth the time. I don't know what to think about this. How many Batmans do we have now? How many more Batman movies do we have to suffer through? Apparently now, you know, the dude who wants to do the Penguin or is doing the Penguin, they're going to get a spinoff on that. I don't know, man. After watching The Peacemaker and the light and fun and raunchy humor that we got out of Peacemaker, like, why would I want to go back to depressing old Batman, you know? Yeah, see? There's no hair metal in the new Batman. There's no fun. There's no quirkiness. It's all dark and depressing. Well, you know what? Let's just stick with the raunchy humor because that's your niche now. Because the House of the Mouse owns Marvel, so you're going to get all, you know, aesthetically clean and antiseptic movies from Marvel. So, you know what, DC? Embrace the naughtiness. Once the magic starts. Also, I really just love this song. Any reason to play this song. But look, the Batman. It's going to be dark and depressing. And I don't want that anymore. I want Batmite. I know, right? Exactly. Who the hell is Batmite? You'll have to watch Peacemaker and find out more because season 2's already approved. That's all I'm saying. It's just like, just DC. Get off your ass and stop trying to imitate Marvel and just do your own thing. Stick with the raunchiness. Stick with the light, not the light humor, the dark and nasty humor. Just go that route. Stop. So I don't know. I'm not overly excited about this whole Batman thing, but you know what? Maybe it'll be okay. Who knows? Who knows? But here.
Hello, lady. We go for white.
What? Is that the one and only Jonathan Huiquan? Kiwiquan? The one and only Data? No Time for Love, Dr. Jones, short round? I mean, seriously, why am I playing him?
Hey, Dr. Jones, No Time for Love!
Well, the reason I'm playing him is because he's got a new movie. He's back from Out of the Shadows. He's coming back from the 80s in his DeLorean. He's got a new movie with Michelle Yeoh, Jamie Lee Curtis. Wait, here it is.
From the Horde.
The movie is called Everything Everywhere All at Once, and it is a multiverse sort of thing. They're taking the whole Doctor Strange multiverse of madness and everything Marvel's doing and just making it for, like, normal people. Take a listen to this.
What's happening?
Devlin, I'm not your husband. I'm another version of him from another universe. I'm here because we need your help.
No time for
love. Very busy today. No time to help you.
No time for love, Dr. Jones!
Across the multiverse, I've seen thousands of Evelyns. You can access all their memories, their emotions, even their skills.
Even their skills. It makes me think of, like, Jet Li's The One. Remember that kick-ass movie, Jet Li? Oh, my God, that was an awesome movie. Okay, I digress, but you get their skills. And so she goes into a montage of ass-kickery.
There's a great evil spreading throughout the many verses. And you may be your only chance of stopping it.
Don't make me fight you. I am really good.
I don't believe you.
Wow, that looks really good.
The universe.
He speaks of senseless things.
Is so much bigger than you and me. Than you realize.
Of all the places I could be.
I just want to be here with you.
Remember our mission concerning the fate of every single world of our infinite multiverse.
There is no way I am the Evelyn you are looking for.
Every rejection, every disappointment has led you here. To this moment. Don't let anything distract you from it.
All right, this movie looks freaking phenomenal. And I forgot one more other important character who's in this. James Hong is also in that. I guess he plays Michelle Yeoh's dad or something, one or the other, grandfather, who knows. But it's David Lopan. Now this really pisses me off. Jack Burton. Oh my God, it's a Big Trouble in Little China. Come on. So, actually, look, I got to meet James Hong one time, and it did not go according to plan. He was at a convention here in town in New Orleans, and I was kind of maybe a little few sheets to the wind, and I was like, I love you, man! And he just like, okay. And we were stuck in a little hallway at like a Holiday Inn, and he just kind of trying to ooze his way around me. I came off a little strange. So, but that is everything. Everything, Everywhere, All at Once, which is coming out in April 6th. April 6th, it is coming out. So I'm looking forward to that. All right, you know what we got to do? We got to take a break. Now, when we come back on the other side, we're going to talk about Doctor Strange 2, you know, the multiverse of madness, and a lot of the casting rumors that are out there. Plus, you know, a certain person's voice, but that certain person also has a new certain show that's about to air on Paramount Plus. We're going to cover all that. And that'll be fun and exciting. But before we go to break, I do want to discuss something real quick or talk about something real quick. Because, look, the whole war in Ukraine right now. It's like, I'm a news guy, you know, we're here on News Talk 99.5 WRNO. And so I've been immersed in everything coming out of the Ukraine. And it's like, I cannot tear myself away. I've been distracted by it by the past few days. You know, I reached out to some friends who have family over there in Poland and the Ukraine, just trying to get a feel for what's going on. And look, this new world that we live in where everything is interconnected between TikTok and Twitter and Reddit and everything like that, you know, you're getting firsthand information where there are actually Ukrainians who are saying, hey, be careful, don't post troop movements and things like that. And just let that percolate in your brain for a minute that, you know, they're live streaming a war right now. It's just insane to me. But it's also like you can't look away. And, you know, look, I'm a 1980s baby. You know, I've seen a bunch of people talking about like Wolverines, and it's kind of crazy to me. But that whole World War III, like a lot of these poor little millennials, they didn't go through the 80s constantly worried about, you know, the Red Menace and the bombs just falling down out of the sky. I mean, it was just the 80s. The Cold War was nuts for us, and we lived through it. We survived. And so now here we are in a new world. And I know a lot of people are panicking. A lot of people are nervous. But I will say one thing. When you look at the way the stock market has gone, that first day the stock market totally tanked. And then you saw the world sort of unite and rally around the Ukraine. You saw the markets tick right back up. I mean, look, typically Wall Street and the stock markets are a panicky bunch, and they just sort of fall apart anytime there's some sort of global crisis that affects the markets. I do a lot of money shows. Sorry, that's why I'm getting into all this. But the whole reason I'm saying this, though, too, is going back to the live streaming media of this war is the whole Wolverines aspect and the people that are in the Ukraine that live and work there every day. It's the size of Texas. You know, there's 1 million people who live just in Kyiv alone. But here's one thing that really stuck out to me. There's a guy over there called Halib Bondrenko. He's a computer programmer. He's a nerd like us. The dude is a gamer, and he does computer programming. That is his job. That's his 9-to-5, Monday through Friday, just like every single one of us. But he stood in line to get a gun to defend his country. Here is Halib Bondrenko.
We are in a queue where people are waiting to get their weapons to fight the Russian invaders. There is no reason to believe that they're going to stop anytime soon, and their objective clearly, at least to me, seems to be the occupation of my entire country and the destruction of everything that I love. I'm just a regular civilian. I have basically nothing to do with war or any other thing like it. And I wouldn't really want to participate in anything like this, but I don't really have any choice because this is my home.
You know, we sometimes kind of crap on millennials and these young kids right now, but this is a younger guy. And, you know, normally he wouldn't participate in war, but he has no choice. And what this gives me hope for this generation. You know, we always talk about the greatest generation of World War II and those baby boomers and such. Holy guacamole. Hat off to Haleeb the Badrenko. I mean, my God, this is just a regular dude, a computer programmer, a nerd who has basically said, you know what? My country's being invaded. I'm going to stand in line, get a gun, and fight. I just love that. It's like it's not a movie to these people, so I'm not trying to make light of what they're doing. I'm honestly in awe and have so much respect for what they're doing because we can't imagine that as Americans. You know, that we haven't had, you know, invaders on our soil since the 1800s. And here these people are, regular Joes, computer programmers, nerds like us, that are grabbing guns and defending their country. And God bless them. God bless the United States of America and the Ukraine and everybody who's helping them out there. All right. When we come back, we'll lighten the mood. We'll talk about Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness and one Jean-Luc Picard. We'll talk about that coming up next right here on The Week in Geek with D-Squared on iHeartRadio. Hey y'all, D-Squared here, and I'm joined by a special guest, the Go Forblin, to bring you a special announcement. That's right. Go Four Games, your friendly neighborhood game shop since 2010, is moving to 4953 West Napoleon Avenue in the Napoleon Plaza. Keep up to date with the move and Go Forblin's adventure on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Go Four Games NOLA and GoForGamesNOLA.com. What's that? Oh, he says he can't wait for you to see his new pick of location at 4953 West Napoleon Avenue.
Welcome back to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Don't forget, you can listen to previous episodes on the iHeartRadio app at The Week in Geek Radio Show. Here's D Squared.
Welcome back in to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I am your host, D Squared. All right, now, as always, I want to strongly urge you to check out the Facebook page, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. Check out our website, or maybe not, at twigradio.com, but definitely follow us on Twitter at twigradio, the Instagram's TheWeekInGeek. And, of course, you can listen to this show anywhere podcasts are freely given away. Stitcher, Spreaker, Spotify. We have a YouTube channel for some ridiculous reason. And, of course, the always faithful iHeartRadio app. Click subscribe. Never miss a pod. All right, before we jump back into the top nerd news, one of the other things I forgot to mention about the whole ongoing battle with Ukraine is Anonymous. I don't even like seeing that name on the air because they scare the bejesus out of me. But yeah, Anonymous hacked the Kremlin. I mean, they hacked the Ministry of Defense. They're just hacking the snot out of Russia. And, you know, all the football teams and the soccer teams and the football teams and like Formula One racing that are really just kind of, you know, jumping on Russia for, you know, basically coming up with an idea to just try to rebuild the old Soviet bloc from back in the day. So I just wanted to put that out there that, I mean, I just, you know, it is a strange world we live in, but my faith in humanity is restored and my faith, which was never shaken, in nerds and geeks across the world. All we're doing and all y'all are doing out there are just proving us right that you mess with a nerd, you get the horns. bull horns. I don't know, but you get what I'm saying. All right, so let's jump back into some fun stuff. May 6th, Doctor Strange 2, The Multiverse of Madness is dropping. And here is, but I never, after the Super Bowl, you know, I never really got to talk about this because it's been kind of crazy. We've been guest heavy. But here's the trailer. And, you know, there's a voice in there that will probably sound familiar.
Every night, I dream the same dream. The nightmare begins.
It didn't really sound like a nightmare. He sounded a little happy.
I did what I had to do.
Oh, sorry.
To protect our world.
You cannot control everything, Strange. You opened the doorway between universes.
Can I just say I love Wong? He's the best. And then I finally got around to watching Shang-Chi and him fighting Abomination. Awesome.
We don't know who or what will walk through it.
Wanda, what do you know about the multiverse?
Viz had his theories. He believed it was dangerous.
He was right.
Dun, dun, dun.
I'm sorry, Stephen. Your desecration of reality. Go unpunished.
He's not happy. Not happy.
We should tell him the truth.
Who was that? Oh my God, who was that? Patrick. Hey, Patrick. Patrick Stewart. Was that you talking just now? Was that you? Is that your voice?
I do have to quickly ask. Everyone's wondering, Twitter's buzzing. Is that your voice in the Doctor Strange trailer? Can you comment on that at all?
Who's Doctor Strange?
Oh, you cheeky little you-know-what's-it. So he refuses to answer, but a non-answer is still an answer.
Things just got out of hand.
Oh, I gotta keep pausing this trailer. Look, I mean, that is directly from What If on Disney Plus. You know, the evil Doctor Strange, things just got out of hand where he just kind of started eating every extra planar being. I think he ate Cthulhu. It was a whole thing. And I'm just so, oh my God, this looks so awesome.
You break the rules.
Look out!
Hero. I do it. I become the enemy.
Well,
that doesn't seem fair.
Well, you did kind of imprison an entire town, lady. So that, you know, let's not compare apples and oranges here. But one of the coolest things to come out of that is the whole Patrick Stewart thing. And sidebar, the new Picard series comes out this Thursday, March 3rd. This Thursday, March 3rd, the first episode of Picard drops on Paramount Plus. So yay, I get to watch that. And then you can all join me out in Biloxi for CoastCon, March 4th, 5th, and 6th. On the 5th, we'll be getting drunk, so don't drive, get an Uber, whatever. All right, so back to Doctor Strange. The casting rumors that have abounded because this is the multiverse of madness. In the Patrick Stewart scene, the Illuminati, which is a bunch of powerful Marvel characters from across the multiverse, Charles Xavier, Captain Picard, well, Captain Picard's not in it, but, you know, Patrick Stewart, who plays Professor Charles Xavier, he's in there. Now, one of the more weirder casting rumors, and this is what's kind of strange. There were a few clips in there that people aren't sure who's what. I fall in the camp of, I think it's Nova, because they had a screenshot what looks like an Iron Man. And so some people are saying that maybe it's, you know, the ultimate Iron Man of Tony Stark. And they're saying Tom Cruise might play it. Please don't put Tom Cruise in a Marvel movie. I'm begging you. You're killing me, Smalls. Don't put Tom Cruise in a Marvel movie, okay? Just stop it. I think it's Nova. I think we'll find out about all that stuff later. But all of this multiverse of madness stuff begs the question, who's going to be showing up in it? We've heard rumors that Tobey Maguire as Spider-Man might show up. We've also heard, and I suspect strongly, that Loki and his friends from the TVA will probably make a guest appearance. Or maybe we'll just see the alligator. I'm totally fine with that. Drop an alligator with some Loki horns. We're good. But also, because Wanda is a big part of this, if you've seen WandaVision, she had two kids, Wiccan and Speed. Those were their names. I had to look it up. I'm not that smart. But there is some talk that maybe she's out there trying to regain her children. So that's a weird, cool little thing. Also, possibly, potentially, we'll get to meet Mr. Fantastic, a.k.a. Reed Richards of the Fantastic Four. I would laugh my butt off if Chris Evans shows up as the Human Torch, because that was his first flop of a superhero movie, even though they made him too. But he came to fame as Captain America, so that would just be funny. But some of the other weirder ones is that perhaps Captain Carter from the What If series, the animated series on Disney Plus, that she might show up, because you've got, you know, the bad Doctor Strange, mean, angry Doctor Strange. So that would be cool. You get Peggy Carter, Captain Carter, who took the super soldier serum instead of Steve Rogers. I'd be totally on board with that. Also, you see, marching up to the Illuminati is a bunch of like Ultron things. Do we get a cameo of that? I don't really know. But then here's the one that has everyone freaking out. Deadpool. Deadpool has been teased, and then Ryan Reynolds kind of threw gas on that fire. So there's a lot of weirdness going on. But then there's a litany of other people that are going to be showing up. I don't know who Bruce Campbell will play, because we've spoken to Bruce Campbell about this. He denied being in the movie, but he did it with a wink, wink, nudge, nudge, say no more, that him and his buddy Sam Raimi, he's always going to put him in a movie. So ideally, he will have some sort of weird cameo. Maybe make him like an older, elderly Wolverine or an Elvis. I don't know. Bubba Hotep, something. I don't know. But I want to see some random ass, you know, Marvel throwback, but it be Bruce Campbell. Are we all down with that? Are we all comfortable with this? All right. So, all right, when we come back, we'll talk to my guy Frank Schiavo of CoastCon coming up this weekend, March 4th, 5th, and 6th over there in Biloxi. CoastCon.org. Get your tickets. We'll be out there having a party on Saturday the 5th. And also, after Frank, we have Professor, Doctor of Astrophysics, Harvard professor. His new book, Extraterrestrial, The First Sign of Intelligent Life Beyond Earth. We'll wrap up the show with him. So Frank, Avi, The Week in Geek with D Squared on iHeartRadio. Box tea again? Why don't you try the tea blends from the Viridian Tea Company? They sell blends that are guaranteed to make you think outside the box. With blends like Quantum Mechanics, Caligula's Herbal Nerve Tonic, and Manta Ray Dreaming, your tea experience will be out of this world. Look for the blends at Tubby and Coos Mid-City Bookshop at 432 North Anthony Street or online at Etsy at the Viridian Tea Company. So put down the box and order some tea from the Viridian Tea Company today. Sincerely, your taste buds.
And from the Storm fanzine highlights Black female characters in comics and sci-fi. The fanzine is for and by Black women, featuring original artwork, interviews, and cultural criticism. As Black women fans, we have unique perspectives that are often silenced and discouraged in mainstream outlets. And from the Storm is a shelter from the storm, a place for Black women to gather, learn, and discuss our Black female nerddom. Find them at infromthestormzine.com or at infromthestorm on Facebook.
This is Kate Mulgrew for The Week in Geek.
Just kidding. It's Mary Elizabeth McGlynn, the Major from Ghost in the Shell. Listen, or the Tachikomas are gonna get you.
Welcome back in to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I am your host, D Squared. Let's go to the guest line. I don't even know what his title is. If he has a title, typically it's like Sir or Knight of CoastCon. The one, the only, Frank Schiavo. Frank, what's kicking, chicken?
Hey, Miss D, how you doing?
I am doing great, man. CoastCon is just a week away, dude. It's right there. You can smell it. It's right there.
Yeah. After 2 years, man, I am so ready. It's time to go.
It has been way too long. So CoastCon, March 4th through the 5th and the 6th, out there at the Gulf Coast Coliseum in Biloxi, CoastCon.org. But Frank, let's talk about the guest list, because you and I were just going to the guest list off air, and it's a beaut, man. Talk about it.
Oh, man, yeah. I mean, I'm talking about New York Times and USA bestselling author Faith Hunter is going to be joining us. This is the first time she's been on the coast in a long time. First time she's ever been to CoastCon. Man, she is so exciting, and it's going to be so fun to have her.
And so, yeah, like Skinwalker and what, Soulwood series? Just like...
Yeah.
There's so
I mean, Jane
much.
Yellowrock is the spirit animal for one half of the readers in our area. So, yeah, you better believe that.
I love that, man.
So we're excited.
And so, look, you know, and then we've got more than that. Then the list of the people that we know, the fan guest of honor, the only Rafe White of Southern Geek, man. I love his picture. It looks like he's in that wind tunnel, but he's like, hey, how you doing? He's got that bouffant handle. I dig it.
That's Rafe doing his sexy nerd fan thing, I guess. I don't know.
And then, of course.
I think Mrs. Rafe likes that.
The Rob Serio. I get a nickel every time somebody says the Rob Serio. So just a note for everyone listening. When you see the Rob Serio, you have to scream, oh, my God, it's the Rob Serio. And then Serio. I get a nickel. That's how I get paid.
I can neither confirm nor deny you should do that.
I've done that in a packed movie theater, and Rob tried to sink into his chair at the movies, but I would not allow him to do that.
So, no, the honor must be bestowed.
It must be. And then our old friend Cyber Ernie, Ernest Russell, is also going to be out there as an author guest. We got a lot of authors. I mean, look, you got Katie Wood, you got Jason Fedora. I mean, the list goes on. Keep going for me, Frank. Good Lord.
Oh, man, yeah. We've got Julie Wetzel, Jen Mahoville. Of course, we've got John Holland, who's local, a comics writer, coming. We're real excited about that. He just signed a deal with someone big for his A Girl and Her Dogs in a comic. So we're really excited about that. And, of course, we've got up-and-coming author Brian D. Anderson, who's been writing for a while, but now his books are starting to just explode everywhere. You can find them on Amazon. By the way, I don't get paid for telling you that. But you can find his Godling Chronicles books there. He's going to be having some at the con, too, so you can pick up some while you're there.
You know what? One of the things is like, which CoastCon is this now? CoastCon 523. Which one is it now? Where are we at?
Man, it feels that way, but no, we're CoastCon 44, my friend.
Wow, that's
maybe it should be 45 or 46 at this point, because we did lose a couple of to some kind of thing that happened in 2020. I'm not sure what it was. Well, now, but it was pretty miserable.
What are we doing at the con though? Like, I know, you know, we're back there at the Coliseum again. And if anybody hasn't been out there in a while, you know, the place is all fancy and gussied up now. What can people who are maybe new to a con, who are just trying to get the hell out of the house or sport their new costume, you know, what can they expect when they get out to CoastCon, Frank?
Well, they can expect to spend as much money as they can possibly bring with them for some of the biggest dealers and vendors from all across the Southeast, people selling games, of course, your Funko Pops, costumes, crafts, anything unimaginable, even food and all sorts of other goodies like that. All of it's available. Celtic themed stuff. I mean, if you want it, I think you can find it. We've also got what it seems like miles of gaming space.
As far as the eye can see, there's tables and your fellow nerds playing board games, role-playing games. That's probably the best part, because you walk in and you just kind of scan the crowd. And your arms open up and everybody just goes, these are my people! My people!
Dude, I mean, with over 2,600 square feet of game, well, more than that, actually, a lot, let's just go a lot of gaming space, we've got it to do. And there's already a schedule for gaming events up online. I mean, at the coastcon.org/coastcongamingspace.
Things
like Dominion, Burning Wheel, AD&D, old school and new school, anything like that.
I like that. Now, Frank, you know, now that I'm getting older, you know, maybe not as much as the party guy as I used to be, one thing I find myself drawn to are panels. And I think, you know, it's funny, you always hear that in, like, commercials or somebody talking about it. You know, we've got a cosplay contest, we've got gaming, we've got panels. I mean, people are like, you mean like the wood paneling in everybody's house in the 70s? But the panels where the guests or other fans get up there and they talk about just a bevy of subjects. I mean, I think that's something that's always kind of glossed over, man.
Oh no, they shouldn't miss it, man. We've got panels on cosplay, we've got panels on your favorite, we've got panels on the MCU, we've got panels on philosophy, we've got panels on anything and everything you can possibly imagine. Contests all weekend long, and we've got exhibits from fan clubs, conventions, and places such as the Science Center in Bay St. Louis, all sorts of things.
Nice.
All over the place.
So one of the other things that we are going to be doing in conjunction with CoastCon, with CoastCon's blessing and, you know, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, we're going to be celebrating our dear departed friend, Brian Held, local celebrity, regional celebrity now, I guess universal celebrity, Brian Held. You know, he passed away, 2 years ago now, Frank, and we are going to be over at the Host Hotel, the Quality Inn, and we're going to have a little bit of a hoedown, I guess is the best way to put it, because it's not going to be a cry in your beer thing. Maybe there will probably be a few tears, but it's more of an Irish wake celebrating his life as opposed to, gosh darn it, he's gone. And, you know, I'm on the radio. I can't say what I really want to say, you know, but it'll be more fun because we'll have DJs and we got an open bar, Frank. Open bar.
Oh, I know, man. That's going to be, but it's our friend and we're going to celebrate him. We miss him, but we're going to celebrate the best of him. And I think that's the whole point of that kind of experience.
Absolutely. Now, well, what else do we have going on besides that? I had to throw that out there, but, you know, because I've been focused on the party stuff, I know we've got more other events going on. What's going on like on Friday and else?
Well, on Friday night, of course, we've got the usual Meet the Guests event, which is Friday evening early on. We're going to have, of course, there are panels going on during the day starting around 2 p.m., There's going to be on Saturday, we've got the charity auction, which is always a big place to pick up great items at a great price and help a great charity, which ours is the Fisher House of Keesler Air Force Base.
Oh, cool.
Which is our friend, yes. And of course, Sunday, we've got the art show sale and auction on Sunday morning.
Nice. So, and
did I mention we have a big cash prize costume contest too?
No, you did not. You glossed over that. Talk about that.
Yes. Of course, as usual, CoastCon's returning with their costume cosplay contest Saturday evening. And of course, it's a cash prize. I can't tell you how much, but you need to see it to be there. And of course, it's got some of the best cosplayers from all over the South going to be participating.
I like that. And apparently, Scungy and I are doing the opening ceremonies, too. So, you know, you'll get dinner and a movie from the Weekend Geek. We'll be out there all weekend long. And actually, I got a hotel room, so I won't be a menace to anyone in the city of Biloxi. It's great. It just works out for everyone.
Yeah, just the hotel, David.
Yeah, and my neighbors in the hotel. So,
We're all going to, we pretty much have the hotel at this point, so you're not going to be disturbing too many people.
So now coastcon.org is where people go for badges, tickets, et cetera. I guess, I'm old school. We call them badges. You know, all the fancy people call them tickets, but these are badges because your badges, we need these stinking badges to get in everywhere. How much are they starting off at coastcon.org? They can get them there, right?
Not now. You're going to have to get him at the door at this point.
Oh, man.
Because we're past the pre-reg date. Man, I'm sorry.
It is a week before.
You know what? We got prices for all that. Oh, man, we got prices for that all set up. First, those beautiful badges designed by our artist guest of honor, Preston A. Savito, by the way.
No, that hack, he's a tracer. He's not an artist. He's a hack tracer. Preston Avocado is his name.
I will neither confirm nor deny that our artist guest of honor is that. Any of that, but man, the badges are beautiful as always. Weekend badges are $50, and they do, and you can get a discount if you're a military or first responder.
Nice.
Friday only badges are $30. Saturday onlys are $45. Sunday onlys are $30 as well. We have a junior rate for ages 9 to 14. They're $25, and Hobbits people ages 8 or younger, they're free with an adult paid membership.
Look at that. I dig that. There you go, parents. So, you know, bring your kids and then, you know, bring them back home and then come back and enjoy the nightlife of CoastCon, too, because there is
that. Of course. Anytime. Yep. We encourage that. I mean, the con runs from 10 a.m. to 1 a.m. on Saturday, noon to 1 a.m. on Friday, and 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. on Sunday.
Frank, look, thank you so much for your time. Thank you for everything you're doing over there for CoastCon and everything you do around here because, well, you know, you're like ubiquitous. You're everywhere. Everywhere you look, you see Frank Schiavo. He's just there, everywhere.
Yeah, I know, hiding somewhere. Anyway.
Frank, look, seriously, thank you so much for your time, and we'll see you out there at CoastCon March 4th, 5th, and 6th out there in Biloxi at the Gulf Coast Coliseum. And, you know, come out there and say hi to the Weekend Geek and enjoy a whole weekend at CoastCon. Frank, thank you, buddy.
I'll see you guys there.
All right. When we come back, Avi Loeb, Harvard professor, astrophysicist, New York Times bestselling author. His new book out now, Extraterrestrial, The First Sign of Intelligent Life Beyond Earth. So when I spoke to him earlier this week, he must have met a bunch of people before he came to our show, and he seemed a little just like defensive because he's basically saying there's proof that there's extraterrestrial life out there and it's visited not just our galaxy but our solar system, and he seemed a little defensive, but I put him at ease somehow. I managed to do that. I don't know how, but we talk about aliens and how he has proof, and all of this is covered in his new book, Extraterrestrial, The First Sign of Intelligent Life Beyond Earth. So, when we come back, we'll talk to Avi Loeb, Harvard professor, New York Times bestselling author. This is The Week in Geek, and this song just started to wind down. Now I gotta play something else. Way to go, Thing.
Greetings, Starfighter. You have been recruited by the Star League to defend the frontier against Zur and the Kodan Armada. Get ready? Prepare for blast-off.
There you go, I did it again. All right, this is The Week in Geek with D-Squared on iHeartRadio. What do you get the nerd who has everything? A gift card from D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe, and let them figure it out. D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe at 8228 Oak Street is open for the holidays, so head over and check out their expanded inventory of miniatures and miniature paints, board games, RPGs, TCGs. Or you can reserve a table for your next game night. Find them on Facebook at D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe, or go to their location at 8228 Oak Street, just two blocks off of Carrollton. Or go to their website at d4cafe.biz.
This is the Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Like them on Facebook and follow them on Twitter at Twig Radio. Do it now.
Welcome back in to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D-Squared. Let's go to the guest line. Astrophysicist, best-selling author, professor of science at Harvard, head of the Galileo Project, and a whole slew of honorifics that we just don't have time for. But Avi Loeb joins us with his new book, Extraterrestrial, The First Sign of Intelligent Life Beyond Earth. Avi, how are you doing today, sir?
I'm doing great, thank you.
So let's talk about this book. Like one of the things that intrigued me was just kind of like your opening, you know, phrases in the beginning of the book, the introduction, where you sort of lay out pretty much, you know, that we've seen something intergalactic that came through, but also how would humans react to finding out that we're not alone in the universe? Talk a little bit about the rest of the things that you put into this book and the point of the book.
Right. So in October 2017, we found the first object from outside the solar system that came close to Earth within the Earth's orbit around the sun. And it didn't look like the rocks we have seen before in the solar system. And it was pushed away from the sun and didn't have a cometary tail. And it was most likely flat, very unusual properties. And I suggested that maybe it is artificial in origin, and that's the subject of my book, Extraterrestrial. And I should say that half a year ago, the Director of National Intelligence delivered a report to Congress where the government admits that there are objects in the sky whose nature is unclear, and therefore there is a new office now in government that will start operations in June 2022 to look into the nature of these objects. And I think it's about time for science to engage and try to figure out whether there are unusual objects of extraterrestrial technological origin in the vicinity of Earth. And that's why I established the Galileo Project about half a year ago. But my book really tells the story about the objects found in 2017.
Now, one of the questions I had was reading about that was that it kind of did a little slingshot in an orbit. You know, thinking about like what NASA does when we send, you know, little flybys by Saturn and Neptune and some of the moons like that, where are those on an orbit trajectory where it's going to come back to Earth, or have we just kind of just shot it out there? Because that's what I was curious about. If they're sending some sort of, you know, like a picture taking probe like NASA does, is it on some sort of elliptical orbit where it's going to go back to them?
No, so... the reason we looked at this object as unusual is that it's moving too fast. It's not bound to the sun. It will never come back.
Okay.
It's in fact, this object was at rest like a buoy on the surface of the ocean. It was at rest in the frame of the Milky Way galaxy, and we just bumped into it. The solar system is moving and just bumped into it like a giant ship. And we gave it a kick, just like a rocket gives a kick to a ping pong ball.
But, I get you.
So it looked really unusual in many ways and didn't look like a rock of a type we've seen before. And the question is, what is it? And so the best way to proceed is to find another object like it. And that's what we hope to do in the coming years. And then have a space mission that will bring a camera very close to it so that we can get a high resolution image. And that would tell us whether it has screws, bolts on it, or whether it's a rock of a type that we've never seen before.
Okay. So Avi Loeb is our guest, author of Extraterrestrial, The First Sign of Intelligent Life Beyond Earth. How do we explain like the Fermi Paradox right now being like the age and the blip of our lifetime, the age of the galaxy, et cetera? I mean, are we too late? Are they too early? What, you know, that's like the Fermi Paradox really just boggles my mind, man.
Well, you shouldn't be too worried about it because 70 years ago, when Enrico Fermi asked, where is everybody? You know, that's just like a fisherman, you know, sitting
where's
on
the fish?
Beach and
looking, right.
And looking at the ocean and saying, where are all the fish? You know, the thing is to find fish, you need to use a fishing net. That's what the telescope systems are all about. You know, he didn't use any telescopes to search for objects in the vicinity of Earth. And just when Oumuamua was discovered, this object from 2017, you know, we just started to scan the sky and we with a survey telescope for the first time in history. And that telescope, Pan-STARRS in Hawaii, is sensitive only to objects as big as a football field. You know, NASA never launched an object as big as a spacecraft, as big as a football field. And there may be many more objects smaller than that that we don't even notice. And so it was really presumptuous of Fermi to say that. And it's just like someone sitting at home and saying, nobody is knocking on my door, therefore I don't have neighbors. You have to look through your windows, and you better use telescopes for that.
I guess on the surface, you make a lot of sense. But I mean, like if you already know there's fish in the sea because you've caught one before, I get that. And, you know, and you talked about it when we first brought you on, you know, having to invest and get out there and observe the universe. I mean, there's a bit of a stigma attached to this research, like of the scientific community. Some, you know, look down on people who try to look up in the sky.
Yeah, but that's very unfortunate, because the only way for us to learn something new is not to assume that we can explain everything with what we already know, okay? And that's the approach of experts. When they, you know, dedicated decades of their lives to looking at rocks in the sky, they would interpret anything in the sky as a rock. It's just like a caveman finding a cell phone. The caveman would argue the cell phone is a rock of a type that I've never seen before. But he wouldn't. And then, of course, if the caveman would press a button, he would realize it's actually not a rock because it can record my voice. Of course, there is, you know, if the technological gap is huge, it will take a while for the caveman to reconstruct, to reverse engineer the cell phone, try to reproduce it. And we may be at the same situation, that we won't really understand what the technology is all about, but we could tell whether it's a rock or not a rock. You know, if we get a high-resolution image of it, or we land on it, and we see some buttons, then it will obviously tell us that it's not a rock.
Now, we only got like 2 minutes left, man. This sucks. I wanted to keep talking to you because I wanted to talk about the Starshot Initiative. But also, though, one of the other things you address in your book, which I guess let's do this instead, was kind of like the end of the world, you know, science fiction storylines that have been out there. Are we ready as a race to meet an extraterrestrial race?
Well, my point is, it doesn't really matter whether we are ready or not. You know, the philosophers during the days of Galileo were not ready to realize that the Earth moves around the sun. Okay, so they didn't look through his telescope. They put him in house arrest. Today they would have canceled him on social media. And that didn't change the motion of the Earth around the sun. You know, it didn't matter.
Right.
So if we don't look through our windows, it would not get rid of our neighbors. Okay, my point is simple, that it's nothing to do with us. There is a reality out there, and, you know, whether we ignore it or not, it still persists. And whether we are ready to admit that it might be out there or not, you know, that's just our limitations. We can continue to have fights with each other over territory and over other issues. You know, that's the story of the day in Ukraine.
Right, yeah.
You know, that's... we can keep ourselves occupied with things that are completely unimportant and in the big scheme of things. But once we realize that we are not the smartest kid on the block, we will have an opportunity to learn from the smarter kid. And that's what I'm advocating for.
Doctor, thank you so much. I really do appreciate it. And thanks for all your time. And I can't wait to finish up the book. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
Yes, sir. All right. So let's start wrapping up tonight's show. I want to thank Frank Schiavo of CoastCon. Come on out there and see us. $50 for an entire weekend. Plus, we're throwing a party / memorial for our dear departed friend, Brian Held. I'm not ready for this crap, man. We're going to try to have fun. And I know there's going to be drinking involved. It's an open bar. So come on out. Tip one back. It's been 2 years and we're finally going to attempt to get some closure on our friend. And man, I don't know if I'm ready for this, but you know what? It is what it is. We're going to be out there, you know, try to maybe cheer us up or we'll cheer you up. I don't really know. All I know is that we're going to have lots of music and we got free booze. So come on out to CoastCon and hang out with us, you know, all weekend long. We're going to be hosting a bunch of things, opening ceremony. So you'll see me and Scungy all around the Coliseum this weekend over there in Biloxi coming up. All right. And of course, you know, Avi Loeb, You know, I guess I misremembered the interview a little bit. I knew we got a little hostile a little bit at one point. But, you know, look, he makes some solid points. Whether or not we are ready for an alien civilization to show up, who knows? But it doesn't matter if we're ready or not, because if they show up, they show up, you know? And ideally, they don't show up like Independence Day or any other, you know, crazy movie where they just try to blow us all up. Hopefully, they, you know, they come in peace and not like the Mars attacks, you know, we come in peace. All right, let's get out of here. I want to thank our guests, but also I want to strongly urge you to check out the Facebook page, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. Check out our website. No, don't do that. But definitely follow us on Twitter at Twig Radio, the Instagram's The Week in Geek. And of course, you can download this podcast at your leisure, Stitcher, Spreaker, Spotify, and of course, the iHeartRadio app. Click subscribe, never miss a pod. And yeah, that just about does it. So I don't know what's going on next week. It's Mardi Gras, man. The next 2 days is just going to be a bit of a blur. And then I go to Biloxi and make another blur. So I'll have about 2 days of sobriety. That'll be Wednesday and Thursday. So till next time, keep your nerd flag raised high.
News Talk 99.5 WRNO FM New Orleans anywhere on our free iHeartRadio app.